I'd like to ask you to think about the things that have changed your life the most in the last, say, 10 years. Just get a little list together. I'm looking at some of you, and I think some of you might have been in high school 10 years ago, so you all have a pretty long list. But the rest of you, how has your life changed the most? What are those things that have changed your life?
Babies.
Babies, me too. Two of them, they're lovely. Some of you probably left this off of your list. It's amazing to think that these devices, mobile phones, have only been around and have only been in our pockets since around 2007. Actually, about 8 years ago this time, I was standing in a dank, dark hallway, elbow to elbow, in solidarity with many people from diverse backgrounds who were waiting for the release of the first iPhone. And since then, my life has never been the same, and yours hasn't either. Estimates are that you will pick up that iPhone 130 times in a given day. Some of you are thinking about picking it up right now. But these devices have allowed us to do amazing things. They've brought new changes into the world. They've messed us up pretty significantly. But nowhere have these changes, I think, been more pervasive and more exciting than in the area of health. We got a chance to see John's brain earlier. I don't have to say anything more. But today, when you go to the doctor, you're going to see the doctor and her computer. And there's a wide range of incredible apps and devices and technology and electronic records that really aim to make our health and healthcare better and more efficient. These are very exciting changes. But we're actually interested in a slightly different question. We're interested in how we can leverage these exciting digital health technologies to improve the health of people who live and work in places like this. Like this. And like this. We're really interested in whether we can take the technologies that have fundamentally changed our lives and improve the health of people who live in medically vulnerable circumstances, racial ethnic minorities, those who live in low-income areas, those who live in rural settings. And I've been doing this work long enough that I remember when we first got started, people used to say this to us all the time. You know, those folks, they don't really use computers. And in fact, about a decade ago, that wasn't completely untrue. We all remember the digital divide and access to computers and broadband internet. But mobile devices have changed everything. These days, a kid in a rural neighborhood can go down to his or her local grocery store and pick up a pay-as-you-go phone that will give them a robust, quick connection to the internet, the same as we all enjoy in our homes. And that has really leveled the playing field in a significant way. And in fact, today we have new divides. And these new divides, I think, are kind of surprising. In fact, all of these things are actually more commonly done by racial ethnic minorities and some low-income populations in our country. And it's exclusively a function of the pervasive nature of mobile devices. So this affords us an amazing opportunity to reach into the communities that we've been trying to target for so long and to do something about the pressing health disparities, the high rates of chronic and infectious disease that plague medically vulnerable communities in our country and across the globe. And so we're focusing in our group on the topic of obesity. We still have an obesity epidemic. It's become so pervasive, I think some of us have forgotten that. But if you live in a medically vulnerable community, up to 7 in 10 of those populations are currently obese. And it's not just that they're more likely to be obese. They're more likely to be obese, but they're more likely to have chronic diseases that travel along with that obesity. They drive healthcare costs, they're less likely to be treated, and when they're treated, those treatments just don't work. In fact, most of the treatments that we have created for obesity in the last 25 years just don't work in medically vulnerable populations, those folks who are most affected. And so that's why we created iOTA. iOTA is a personalized digital health platform for delivering a high-quality, evidence-based obesity treatment to medically vulnerable populations. What iOTA does is to say, if you live in a neighborhood like this, and if this is where you get your fruits and vegetables, then it becomes unreasonable for me to tell you to eat green leafy vegetables and eat some more fruits and get some skim milk in order to reduce your calories. Those things are just not available. iOTA is a reaction to this challenge. Only 3 in 10 Americans can tell us accurately how many calories they would consume if they ate the entire container of ice cream. Just 3 in 10. We have pressing literacy and numeracy challenges in our population, and that makes doing obesity treatment very challenging. So what we do in iOTA is that we've developed complex computer algorithms that consider where you live, what you eat, what you drink. They reach into your psychology, they consider your motivation, your readiness, your self-efficacy, and we wrap all of that up and we deliver very simple goals. So simple that they almost seem laughable in some ways. But what we know in the back end is exactly how much weight a person will lose if they do these goals, and if they track their adherence to these goals using one of the technologies that we've created. We designed iOTA to be simple, and we designed iOTA for people like Sandra. Sandra is a woman I encountered in a study that we just finished a couple of years ago. Sandra's about 35 years old. She has two kids, and she has two jobs. She lives in Burlington, North Carolina, which is sandwiched between Greensboro and Durham. And every moment of her day is spent thinking about how she's going to improve the life of her children. She aspires to be a nurse, but she doesn't have enough money to go back to school right now. All she can do is to work these two jobs and try to save up enough money to make that dream a reality. Sandra is extraordinarily proud. She doesn't want people to know that sometimes she needs a helping hand. And she goes to great lengths to hide this from her kids. Sandra also gets down sometimes. And if you talk to her, she would tell you it's stress, but I'd call it depression. And so it really should be no surprise that Sandra is not all that concerned about the fact that she has obesity, and that she has hypertension, and that she has high cholesterol. These things are just not concerns for her. And the problem for women like Sandra, who we encounter frequently in our work, is that you can think about obesity as a fever. At low levels of obesity, there's a lot of controversy about exactly how bad it is. But as people gain weight and they get to high levels of obesity, there really is no controversy. You're going to experience a negative outcome. And the problem for medically vulnerable populations is that they start early adulthood at a higher rate of obesity, and then they gain rapid amounts of weight. Women like Sandra gain 3 to 5 pounds a year, and they stay in that high-risk zone for much of their life. And what we've begun to ask is, we can't get them to lose weight. It's just not a priority. But can we lower their risk by just stabilizing those weight gains, keeping them from gaining weight during their childbearing years and setting themselves up for all of these health problems? And that's what we offered Sandra when she came in for one of our studies. She sat down at a tablet computer. Incidentally, most of the people we interact with have never touched a keyboard and have no idea how to use a mouse, but they've been using phones for so long that they know how to use tablets. So they sit down, she fills out her survey, she gets her personalized goals. She tracks how well she's doing each day using one of our text messaging-based programs. She gets personalized feedback. Those data go back to a coach who helps her to stay on track, helps her to problem solve. And then, after 18 months, Sandra stopped gaining. Sandra had no more weight gains. Her cardiovascular dysfunction stabilized. We came back 4 years later, no gain. Women like Sandra in our studies have stopped gaining. All their cardiometabolic dysfunction is stabilized from this very simple, inexpensive treatment. And I mentioned that she got down. Well, for reasons that we don't completely understand, this treatment reduces depression by 70%. And so women like Sandra, 25% of whom are clinically depressed when we see them and not receiving treatment, just by interacting with this text messaging-based treatment, can be healed. We've been testing iOTA in a range of treatments over the last decade, and it does a lot of things. It does all of these things here, and the Surgeon General caught wind of this and said, you guys, you really need to take this to scale. You need to allow this to reach large populations, and that's what we want to do. It's one thing for a treatment like this to affect the life of a single person, but there are millions of Sandras out there who need our help, and I hope that you'll work with us to make our dream of allowing a treatment like this to touch millions of lives a reality.